these maps of time because we don't have any other way to picture what time might be. One reason people are grateful for the Menard map is that it is an example of how we might plot time, contain time, master time. Now, professional historians build on this native ability that all of us have to create ever more detailed maps of the past in their heads. The more coordinates we have, the better. The parts of the time landscape I know well are detailed, full of familiar landmarks. I can tell you the difference between the first half of 1831 and the second half of 1831. I've lived back there so much time that I can actually picture what it might look like. I can actually see a density of information in my head. I can zoom down into those time maps and then back out to see larger and larger patterns, like a shot from a satellite. I can see in my mind processes unfolding, things connecting and branching and stopping. And I have to admit, the fantasy I have is, wouldn't it be great if we could actually show that to somebody else? If I could find a way, and I should just tell you, I haven't. But wouldn't it be great if there were ways to make what is in our heads visible, to make the expert knowledge of history visible so that other people could benefit from it, test it, and maybe reject it? It turns out I've been asking my historian friends, quick, tell me, what does the history in your head look like? Describe to me, how do you know what somebody comes in and says, tell me a good book about the Progressive Era. How do you do it? And they say, don't know about this little talk. And I say, is it like a database? Is it like the library where you go searching? They said, no. I said, I can just picture. Okay, there was a book, Weeby in the 70s, picture. Yeah, people laughing here, no, right? And you sort of picture it out. And that they actually have a map in their head of professional knowledge. So it's not merely a map of time, but it's also a map of what we know about time that people have in our heads. So if we made this kind of expert knowledge visible and shared it with others, that strikes me that would be cool. Now, visual and spatial patterns of the past will help us to understand the past in more subtle and complex and thus more accurate ways, just in the same way as we understand nature. Dick was talking about the humanities becoming more like the sciences. Sitting on P&T cases, promotion and tenure cases, and I look at the files of people, I just notice that the scientists use images all the time and try to come in and say, here, describe what this molecule looks like in words. Isn't it a crazy request? And yet historians think that we can describe anything in words, and that is what we're good at. And in fact, because we are so good with words, we've actively suppressed a large part of the visual and the graphic. And that's not necessary for us to do it that way. These things don't have to be at war. I love books, as you can tell. I love words. But what if we tapped into some of these older traditions that are sometimes neglected? Now, we need different kinds of maps of time in our heads. Driving from Miami to San Diego, we could just draw one big red line, Menard-like, okay, from one place to the other, and say, that's how you get there. And that's what people do in American history a lot of the time. They'll have secession, and they draw it to emancipation. Okay, that's what we're doing. But I think we've seen in the graphs of language that it wasn't a straight line. And certainly, if you look at the battlefield history, all the twists and turns and surprises, it certainly was not a straight line. So how do we draw maps that aren't such radical simplifications that they're not accurate? So it's like trying, sometimes you want a map that just sort of says, okay, here's where the interstate runs from one coast to another, but that doesn't get you to anybody's driveway, right? You're going to have those other kinds of maps that work at these different kinds of scales, and it strikes me that history is going to need much the same sort of thing. One analogy might be that weather maps. Mark Twain said, climate is what we expect, but weather is what we get. To understand history, we have to understand the historical weather. We're going to understand why people did the things they did. And that historical weather changed relentlessly, unpredictably. Even with our satellites and computers, we're still not very good at predicting weather, but we're great at analyzing it after it's happened. And that's what history is. We can go back, and we can't predict what would have happened, but we know where the hurricanes ended up hitting. We can go back and look at water temperature. We can go back and look at these kinds of things and retrodict the past, and in the process of learning something important about all this. So history never travels as the crow flies. History walks. History is on the ground. History hits obstacles and has to walk around rivers. can't just fly over history and know what it's like. It's like trying to say you're going to drive from Maine to San Diego and neglect to mention that there are Rocky Mountains and Great Plains in between. It's a different experience if you know that those things are coming. The beauty and utility of history is that time, the all-important fourth dimension in which we live and in which we humans, alone of all living things, are aware, can be mapped as it cannot be in our own lives. We have no idea where we are in the time of our lives. We have no idea if we're 2 days away from the end of it. We have no idea if there are decades stretching ahead of us. We can't know. You can look back at your time. That's what the photo albums are for. That's what the memories around the table are about, trying to map time. Remember this. Remember when we did this. Trying to give it some kind of shape, because otherwise it just keeps coming. It's relentless. Unlike space, when you can learn a space, you can never learn time, because it never stops. So, but with history, we can go back and at least think about collective time in a way that gives us some bearings.